My first page opens on a diarist caught up in London's swinging 60s, a young exhibitionist who boldly drew attention to himself. In 1966, Joe Orton was 33, young and full of life, a playwright whose whole raison d'etre was to shock and entertain. He was promiscuous and gay at a time when it was still illegal. He wrote about his homosexuality in his diary, refusing to hide it. He wanted to use the truth to expose hypocrisy. He wrote as he lived, taking risks, pushing the boundaries, challenging the strictures of society. But telling the truth came at a price.
Is it odd for you to come back to the places where he... Is it too long ago? Is it odd for you to come back?
No, it isn't. It's OK. I'm all right.
I've come with Leonie Barnett, Joe's sister, to Islington Library. In 1962, Joe and his lover had already made a splash in this buttoned-up, regimented place by giving the books a bit of a makeover.
Read this behind closed doors and have a good shit whilst you're reading it. That's the sort of thing that shocked quite a number of our readers, the elderly, more ladylike ones. I must say that I and many of my colleagues almost looked forward to seeing these. They were amusing to us, but at the same time, of course, this was... an attack on our books. Our book stock, of which we were very proud, was being attacked by predators.
Oh, they... These are all cleverly cut out with a razor blade, I think.
So this got them into prison?
Well, so they say. You wouldn't get
what
sent to prison. Well, I think they got sent to prison because they were homosexuals, because they were gay. Mm. And they did too.
Orton and his boyfriend Kenneth Hannawell paid a heavy price for their relatively lightweight crime, spending 6 months behind bars.
There's some irony that these are the very things that are now the prized possessions of the library.
Absolutely, yeah. Mm.
But prison didn't put Orton off, it spurred him on. It shaped his view that society was rotten and pushed him to write plays that said so, and people loved them. In 1966, Orton's agent suggested he keep a diary of his rise to fame. He agreed, knowing that it would reveal all the details of his promiscuous encounters and expose his relationship with Kenneth Hannawell. Within 8 months, he was dead, murdered by the man closest to him, the man whose confidences he had betrayed. Joe's ashes were mixed with Kenneth's and scattered on the lawn at Golders Green Crematorium. For Leonie, who hasn't been back since the funeral 40 years ago, it's a place rich with memories.
It's very odd, isn't it, standing in the spot where the ashes were thrown. So somewhere in this earth piece here might be just a few little particles of Joe still.
Monday, May the 1st, Kenneth H. had a long talk about our relationship. He threatens or keeps saying he will commit suicide. He says, "You'll learn then, won't you? And what will you be like without me?" We talked and talked until I was exhausted, going round in circles.
Did you say that you thought that the diaries precipitated his murder?
Well, yes. Yeah. There was something in those diaries...
Because of the diaries?
..that Kenneth Halliwell had read that obviously tipped him over.
Kenneth Halliwell had been Joe Orton's partner for 16 years. They'd met at RADA in 1951 and had been inseparable ever since. They lived together in a tiny 15-foot square bedsit in Noel Road in Islington.
We never knew, you know. We never knew that Joe was gay. And I went, and I remember going to my father's house. Oh, it was 3 or 4 months after Joe's death. And he says, "Do you know," he says, "round here," he says, "they say that Joe's a bum boy." And I said, "Oh, really, Dad?" Was a bum boy, that's it. So I said, well, maybe he was, Dad. Just doesn't matter, though, does it, now he's dead? And he said, "No, it don't matter now, does it?" He says, "But do you reckon he was?" And I thought, oh, poor man, he wants me to say, "I'm sure he wasn't."
And so what did you say?
I just said it didn't matter.
Right.
I said he's dead now.
But your mother knew?
I don't think so.
You don't think so?
No. Well, unless... I mean, my mother used to have a wonderful saying, and that was, you don't need a weatherman to tell you which way the wind's blowing.
Right.
And then she'd say... It's wonderful. See, my mother, she was wonderful. And and when she said to Joe, what do you want to live with a bald-headed man for? And I think that she knew.
She knew, but that was the way... It was just that thing that she didn't say, but she knew.
She would never say it. No, she wouldn't say it. No.
After Kenneth had gone, I cleaned the bathroom, had a glass of milk, and went down the Holloway Road in search of a bit of sex. I went to a back street near the tube station and into a lavatory. I passed through the place, looking to see if any were worth having, and suddenly noticed that one, a youngish man, wasn't bad. "Where do you come from?" he said a bit later. "Leicester," I said. "I've got a mate who plays for Leicester City," he said. I slept with him on the night before his wedding.
The diaries formed a prop in the relationship to Halliwell because these diaries, which are as intimate and funny and devastating as any that we have for the period, were written literally under Halliwell's nose and put away in the desk so that there was no way that Halliwell did not know that they were being written and would not have read them. And I think myself, it seems clear that Orton was trying to tell Halliwell that he wanted space, that he wanted a kind of separation.
From the diaries, you know, just having reread them, you know, now, so they're fresh in my mind, I suppose the taunting that he felt that Joe's success had, and that he was so sexually successful with whoever he wanted, and he could have, you know, he was in the sweetie shop and
yes,
everything was being given his way, and the other one couldn't get anything.
No.
That it was intolerable to live with that anymore. So the only way that he could end it was to murder him.
Well, yes.
I think it's bad we live in each other's pockets 24 hours a day, 365 days of the year. When I'm away, Kenneth does nothing, meets nobody. What's to be done? He's now taking tranquilizers to calm his nerves.
In August 1967, Kenneth killed Joe, smashing his skull 9 times with a hammer. Kenneth then committed suicide and left a note that said, "If you read his diary, all will be explained. P.S., especially the latter part." Joe Orton's celebrity and promiscuity had been the death sentence to their relationship. But in the end, it was the diaries that provoked Kenneth into wielding the hammer.
I think in his fragile state, mm-hmm. you know, he was going into hospital the next day. Almost, you could say, he'd been committed.
Right.
And I think that whatever was in those diaries, he certainly didn't want to live anymore.
Right.
And unfortunately, he took Joe with him.
So even though the diaries were the instrument that precipitated his murder, they're the things that keep him alive as well.
Oh, yes. Oh, very much
so. Another great beauty of a diary is that you do go into the very day that the person has written those. So whatever the day that it is,
it's like no time stop. It's like a snapshot, isn't it?
Completely.
And
time just stops.
Yes. And you can pick them up and open them anywhere and before you know where you are. I mean, you're laughing.
Yeah.
They are fun.
That's a great gift.
Such fun to read.
I think they're the best diaries of the post-war period, full stop, in terms of the culture. Because they're brilliantly written, hilarious, and caustic.
Mum was quite unrecognisable without her glasses. They'd scraped her hair back off her forehead. She looked fat, old, and dead. They'd made up her face, and when I asked about it, the mortician said, "Would you say it wasn't discreet then, sir?" I said, "No, it seems all right to me." "We try to give a lifelike impression," he said, which seems to be a bit of a contradiction in terms, somehow.
What is lovely about him, there's no self-deception, is there? Or very little self-deception. I mean, we all self-deceive. But, I mean, there's so little self-deception, I think, in the diaries. He says things like, I don't really care about reviews anyway. And then the next sentence he'll say, of course, we all do.
Yeah.
And I love that.
Yeah, it's very human.
It's like when he says, we're having a non-conformist Christmas. He says, we're having cheese sandwiches. And then he says, only because the chicken's not thawed out. So, I mean, the thing is, you know, that's lovely, isn't it?
Will you read a bit from his diary?
What? Yeah.
Do you mind?
No.
You're a good sport.
All right. Well, there's two things, really, I think, that it's really... really makes me laugh. And it said, on our way home, we passed the Palace Theatre, where the sound of music is playing. I heard a woman saying, I've seen that show 3 times. A lovely evening out. I'd go through it again, only they're bringing it off. And then there's another one where this Miss Boynes is on the stairs with an expression of misery on her face. Jenny's passed away, she said. Jenny is a foul, fat, malting budgerigar. Miss Boynes has 3 in all. All, of course, she said. I know Jen wasn't a young bird when I bought her. And she was delicate. That's why she never got on with Sweep.
I think that what I've gleaned from Leonie today is that her brother Joe used his diary to transform his real life into a work of art. And it was shocking and very funny. But I think to its first reader, Kenneth Halliwell, the diary was the ultimate act of betrayal. It painted a picture of him as sexually uninteresting, as someone overlooked. What he read in black and white was something that Orton had never said aloud, that he didn't want Kenneth anymore. And the real power of Joe Orton's diary, it wasn't that it contained secrets, it was that it told the truth.
I was absolutely riveted to meet Joe Orton's sister, because she had such passion and ferocity in her, and the keeper of the flame of Joe Orton. To me, it was absolutely obvious that there's a kind of inevitability that this very unstable, needy man, emotionally so stunted, had no option but to opt for the violent end for himself and for Joe Orton.